Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup and we will be discussing the muscles in the posterior compartment of the thigh, and after we've completed this video we will have discussed those three large compartments associated with the thigh. So as typical, we will discuss which muscles are located in this compartment, as well as of course the innervation, the attachments, and that all important topic of the actions. So the muscles in the posterior compartment of the thigh are more commonly referred to as the hamstring muscles. And this name is not a particularly glamorous one. It's named after the common method of hanging pork thighs or hams around the tendons of these muscles. So hamstrings indicating the tendons. I don't love the name, but it is so commonly used, it cannot be avoided. And so do understand when we're talking about the posterior compartment, you will often hear this referred to as the hamstrings or the hammies. These are three long muscles associated with the posterior compartment. There will be two muscles that are more medial, and then one muscle that is more lateral. So the two medial hamstring muscles are the more superficial semitendinosus, which you can see kind of right here, and the semimembranosus. And the semitendinosus tends to be the more superficial one. It tends to have a more prominent kind of rope-like tendon, which you can see here. Oftentimes the tendon is a little bit longer than what you see on this particular donor here. Oftentimes the tendon almost takes up half of the actual span of this muscle. And it will sit right on top of the semimembranosus. The semimembranosus is named because of the more flattened, membranous looking tendon. So all this white right here is going to, I went a little too far there. All that white right here is the tendon of the semimembranosus, which is a bit more flattened. And so both the semitendinosus and the semimembranosus are more medially placed. So this is going to be medial. And on the lateral side, there will be the biceps femoris muscle, which, as the biceps might clue you in, there are two heads associated with this muscle. The long head is the one you see best from a more superficial view. So right here is your biceps femoris, and really what you're looking at here is the long head. And this is the long head is the more characteristically hamstringy associated muscle. Hamstringy is definitely a scientific word, I assure you. Anyway, what I'm meaning here more is that the long head has all the characteristics and shares characteristics with the other two hamstring muscles, whereas the short head is kind of the exception in terms of not sharing some of those important characteristics with the rest of the hamstrings, such as proximal attachment and innervation. So there are some important differences there. The hamstrings as a group can be thought of as a two-joint muscle crossing both the hip and the knee joints and play important roles in actions occurring at both. So the hamstring muscles will play a role in extension of the hip joint. So the hip joint in both of these images or illustrations are extended. And so it is particularly important in extension that occurs with walking on a flat ground or even in just a regular standing position. So that type of extension, that's not quite as forceful. Do you remember the other major extensor of the hip joint from some other learning objectives? The other major extensor of the hip joint is the gluteus maximus, and recall that the gluteus maximus is particularly important for more forceful or powerful extension of the hip joint. The hamstrings will also flex the knee joint. So think of bending the knee joint. The leg will go posteriorly when we're talking in this region. So that's kind of a difference usually with flexion. Things kind of go anteriorly. That's not what occurs at the knee joint and with the leg. And flexion of the knee joint is what people tend to think of when considering the actions of the posterior compartment of the thigh. And these are the primary movers for flexion of the knee joint. All right, these muscles are also, or they're going to be mostly innervated by the tibial division of the sciatic nerve. So we have finally made it to a compartment that is innervated by the sciatic nerve, and it will be branches of the sciatic nerve from here on out for the rest of the lower limb. In the posterior thigh, the sciatic nerve typically presents as one large nerve. In fact, it is the largest nerve of the body. You will be quite impressed with the size of the sciatic nerve. But it's really just a composition of two parts that are bundled together. And these are the tibial division and the common fibular, very often referred to as the common peroneal, the more traditional term, nerve. And here in the posterior knee region, which is what we're looking at here, a region referred to as the popliteal fossa, you can see that they finally will kind of separate from one another. So here's the sciatic nerve. The tibial nerve will split. It's the larger one. And then the common fibular or peroneal will split right around this region. But if you're still in the posterior thigh, you really just have the sciatic nerve that's just bundling those two parts together. So what you will have in the posterior thigh are those muscular branches coming off of the tibial division of the sciatic nerve. So it really, even though you could say it is innervated by the sciatic nerve because it looks like just one bundle there, it's true, those fibers are truly coming off of that tibial division. The one exception is the short head of the biceps. I told you that would be the exception. And this is going to be innervated by that other division, the common fibular or peroneal. So a specific divisional injury of the sciatic nerve would affect one head of the biceps femoris and not the other. Now, instead of discussing the distal attachments like I typically do, I want to instead focus on the proximal attachments of these muscles, which are all the way up on the ischial tuberosity, I'm circling the ischial tuberosity right here, of the ischium. And recall, the ischium is that more posterior component of the coxal bone. So this kind of rounding, thickening, mounding of bone right here. The ischial tuberosities are sometimes called your sit bones because when you sit down, the gluteus maximus kind of repositions in a way that you're mostly sitting on skin, subcutaneous tissue, and these ischial tuberosities. In terms of distal attachments, the medial hamstring muscles are going to be attaching on the medial tibia. And the lateral biceps femoris attaches on the lateral fibula. Excellent. Thank you for your time and attention here. And please always feel free to reach out with any questions you may have.